proceed now with our very special and honored guest, Dr. Abdulrahman Bizri, mayor of Saida. You saw many of the refugees fleeing from the south of Lebanon, many of them aimed for the city of Saida. Mr. Bizri.
Baroness Nicholson, Your Excellency the Syrian Ambassador, Your Excellency the Lebanese Ambassador, dignitaries, friends of Lebanon, ladies and gentlemen, it's really very sad to talk just after this very impressive presentation, although I have experienced most of what you have seen. And I was there all throughout the whole 34 days. And I thank Ms. Mansour for what she has presented. And despite all the atrocities and the savagery you have seen, the Lebanese people in general, and the southerners in particular, are very tenaciously stubborn people. They are very resilient, and they are very proud of their country. And a better expression of their pride was the fact that they immediately, as Ms. Mansour has mentioned, immediately, and to the astonishment of everybody, they immediately went back to their villages, irrespective of the threats, irrespective of the plea, and irrespective of what really people who designed the 1701 have planned. If Lebanon won this war and the resistance won this war, it's the Lebanese people who also won this war, because they really prove again and again yet that it will probably need more than Israeli planes and American rockets to really break the resilience of the Lebanese. Well, to change slightly the sadness of our note, it is very important to mention that tomorrow we'll be celebrating the Day of Resistance and the Day of Liberation. And this really coincides, and it's of a lot of importance that it coincides with the day when the Lebanese have managed to secure some sort of a pact or an accord in Doha. Despite the fact that we have achieved a lot in Doha, and this achievement will probably put, at least for now, an end to the tension and the civil strife that was experienced in Lebanon, we have really to keep prepared, and we have really to keep our toes on our toes, and really we have to make sure that the Doha Accord should be the beginning, because we have really to work a lot in order to achieve a peaceful settlement, because Lebanon has experienced so many accords, so many agreements and disagreements, unfortunately, for many different reasons and for several reasons, they have failed to continue. However, it's also of a very happy note to mention that the first act of our future president, General Sulaiman, will be to restore the holiday on the Day of Liberation of the South of Lebanon. It's unfortunate. That the Prime Minister's Senura government did not really think it's worthy or worthwhile to have a Liberation Day in Lebanon. Maybe, well, we're not going to talk a lot about internal politics, maybe because they don't think that liberation from the Israeli occupation was an important deed, in fact. However, it's also important to mention another thing, because if you look at the media, mainly at the international media, many wanted really us to think that there was some sort of a sectarian struggle or a sectarian fight in Lebanon. Many wanted to express the conflict in sectarian terms, which means that there is a Sunni versus a Shia issue. Well, this is definitely not true. And as a good example of that, well, I'm a Muslim and I'm a Sunni, and I am the mayor of one of the largest Sunni cities, and I am here really to speak on the behalf of the resistance. The resistance is for all Lebanese, and the issue is never really a sectarian issue and was never a sectarian issue. It is simply an argument, or it is simply an issue between two different political points of view. One political point of view, which the so-called current majority in parliament holds, they believe that Lebanon should be part of what we call the package of the new Middle East that is now being promoted by the Americans and the so-called moderate Arabs. Others in Lebanon believe that the only way for Lebanon to become again a leading country in the Middle East and in the Arab world is really to regain back its pride, and the only way we can really have our pride and have our sovereignty and be sovereign and have our own, be masters of our faith really, is by really dropping the saying that used to be said and promoted in the past, that the strength of Lebanon lies within its weakness. It's not definitely true. The strength of Lebanon lies within its strengths as well, in its resistance, in the ability of its people, of the whole Lebanese people, to live together. So what we have really experienced in the last few days, in the last weeks, although unfortunate, because we never really wanted to resort to violence to settle internal matters, was simply a political issue and never really a sectarian issue. And this really brings us in this day, when we celebrate the liberation of Lebanon, brings us to the important question of, do we need resistance anymore? Do we need the arms of Hezbollah anymore? And I will try to go along with you trying to answer these questions. And my talk will mainly focus on Lebanese resistance to the Israeli occupation. How and why it started, whether still there is any need for retaining and upgrading the military preparedness of the Lebanese resistance. Well, to go back a little bit, I'm sure most of you know that it is a well-known fact that the state of Israel receives formidable support from the United States of America. And American policy in the Middle East